that coral reefs are struggling with climate change, and there is an urgent need to understand the mechanisms behind thermal tolerance in corals so that we can best manage coral reefs, securing their persistence into the future under predicted climate conditions. And high temperature variable environments have been found to harbour naturally heat resistant corals and may play a key role in providing stocks of heat tolerant corals in future reef restoration projects. However, restoration projects rely on corals from these environments to retain the desired trait of heat tolerance once transplanted into this new environment. So putting this theory into practice, the aim of this study was to test the thermal performance of an aquifer species following reciprocal transplantation from a high and low temperature variable environment, and to determine the role in which long-term acclimatization plays in modifying the thermal performance. To test thermal performance, I aim to assess survival and bleaching recovery of corals following a natural bleaching event in 2020. I also aim to identify bleaching sensitivity and recovery of hard coral cover between a high and a low temperature variable environment to assess thermal tolerance between sites across a range of genera. The high temperature variable environment that I was interested in is Tahala Reef, which is a well-studied inshore fringing reef 3 kilometres off the central Saudi Arabian coastline. Based on previous studies, the high diurnal temperature variability in the back reef or the sheltered side is thought to promote higher thermal tolerance. And this was evidenced by higher bleaching susceptibility of corals in the exposed versus the sheltered side during a natural bleaching event in 2010. And heat stress experiments, which showed higher thermal tolerance in the coral Stylophora fistulata from the sheltered side. So these findings made it an ideal location to perform a reciprocal transplant experiment where I could assess whether historical thermal regime limited or promoted coral acclimatization and thermal tolerance. So the map on the left is from my study, and the red dots show the common garden area in which the corals were transplanted to, and the red boxes indicates the area in which the corals were collected, and there is around 300 meter distance between the two common garden areas. So the species that I chose to work with was Acropora hempriki, which is abundant throughout the Red Sea and is a dominant reef builder susceptible to heat stress. Collection of coral fragments was conducted in November 2019 and consisted of finding whole coral colonies and then detaching two similar sized fragments. One fragment was back transplanted to the same side of the reef and used as a control, whereas the other fragment was transported to the opposite side of the reef and attached to seal rods, which were evenly spaced in a common garden area. Temperature loggers were deployed on each side of the reef at the locations of the coral gardens and measured temperature every 10 minutes. Excuse me, sorry. 9 months after transplantation of the corals into their new environment, prolonged high temperatures in summer caused bleaching of corals in October 2020. To monitor the severity of the bleaching, I assessed survival and condition of the corals weekly for 10 weeks. And to assess coral recovery, I noted the colour of each coral and how it changed over time using the coral watch health chart, with darker colours corresponding to increased symbiont density. I also monitored bleaching and recovery of hard coral cover between the two sites, and I did this by conducting belt transect surveys whereby I would take a series of photographs on each side of the transect and then record colony condition, including a health score based on the coral watch health chart. And the transects were fixed in place so that I could return to the same location weekly and monitor the same corals over time to assess individual recovery across a range of genera. So this graph shows the in situ temperature data that was collected at the two study sites throughout the experimental time period. And what I want to draw your attention to is the red line, which shows degree heating week data that was downloaded from the Coral Reef Watch website. And degree heating weeks is basically a measure of how much temperature stress there is in a given region using satellite-derived sea surface temperature. So anything higher than 80 degree heating weeks is expected to cause widespread bleaching and mortality. During this bleaching event, degree heating weeks peaked at 11.8 in October, which is higher than previous bleaching events in this area over the past decade. So I did predict that there was going to be high levels of bleaching. So first I'm going to take you through the bleaching and recovery results of the belt transect surveys. When comparing hard coral cover bleaching percentages between the two sites, I found there was significantly higher bleaching on the exposed side than the sheltered, which was in fact expected given previous studies. However, despite higher temperatures and degree heating weeks during 2020 compared to a marine heat wave recorded in 2010, overall percentage of bleached charred coral on the exposed side decreased from 100% in 2010 to less than 60% in 2020. So this suggests that the overall thermal tolerance of hard corals may have increased over the past decade. And this could be attributed to many reasons. For example, a shift in coral communities to more resilient and thermal tolerant species, adaptation from the 2010 thermal event, long-term physiological acclimatization, or perhaps successful shuffling of symbionts to more heat-tolerant species. When I looked into bleaching resistance between sites and genus, I found evidence of habitat-specific thermal tolerance. So if you look at percent coral cover in this graph on the right, you can see that parietes was the most common genus and is equally represented at both sites with no significant differences in coral cover. However, this genus did have a significant difference in bleaching percentage between sites, indicating that parietes has higher thermal tolerance at the exposed site compared to the sheltered. So although there were differences in bleaching severity between the two sites, recovery time following the bleaching event was actually very similar. This graph shows the average bleaching chart scale of hard coral cover between exposed and sheltered over time. And as shown in the previous slide, the exposed site had more severe bleaching than the sheltered, which is represented in this graph in the first two data points, where the exposed showed a significantly lower average color score on the bleaching chart than the sheltered. Since the exposed site had overall more severe bleaching, yet showed similar symbiont recovery time as the sheltered, it can be said that corals in the exposed site had higher resilience against this bleaching event. However, when I compared mortality percentage of hard coral cover at the end of monitoring, I found there to be significantly higher mortality on the exposed side compared to the sheltered. So the results of the transplantation experiment were quite interesting and actually unexpected. So I found that corals transplanted from the exposed to the sheltered environment increased their percentage survival by 20% compared to the control, and actually surpassed survival of the native sheltered corals, indicating that this high temperature variable environment promoted thermal tolerance. In contrast to this, corals transplanted from the shelter to the exposed environment decreased their percentage survival also by 20% compared to the sheltered native corals. And this indicates that environmental conditions in the low temperature variable environment lowered thermal tolerance in these corals originating from the high temperature variable environment. So based on these results, I wanted to see if there was any correlation between survival and treatments and recovery speed of the corals. A study in 2006 found that a change in bleaching chart scale of 2 represents a significant change in symbiont density. I use this value as a guide to work out which treatments showed faster recovery. So on the graph, I've indicated the point in which each treatment passed the threshold for a significant change in symbiont density relative to the first week of monitoring. The treatment that was originated from the exposed and transplanted to the sheltered showed the fastest significant increase in symbiont density. As shown on the previous slide, this treatment also had the highest percentage survival. So in order to understand the relationship between recovery speed and survival better, I investigated what actually drives symbiont recovery in corals. And this brings me to coral host fluorescence. Fluorescence of corals during bleaching is driven by an optical feedback loop in which the production or downregulation of host pigments is influenced by the presence or the absence of the symba. So basically what this means is that when corals are in a healthy state, most of the incident light is absorbed by the algal symbionts, and when the coral is in a bleached state, increased light fluxes promote the production of fluorescent proteins in the coral host. And these pigments will absorb the incoming light, reducing the light fluxes, which then promotes return of algae symbionts, creating an environment that they can thrive in. So once the algae return, the expression of fluorescent proteins decreases. During the bleaching event, corals in the transplantation experiment visibly fluoresced, and I found that corals which did fluoresce were actually more likely to survive. So I found a strong negative correlation between the percentage of corals that fluoresced in a treatment and the percentage of coral mortality, whereby the higher number of corals in a treatment that displayed visible fluorescence, the lower the percentage mortality of corals in that treatment. Previous studies have shown that fluorescence can impact bleaching resistance. However, the production of fluorescent proteins is energetically demanding and will depend on the ability of the coral to catabolize energy reserves, heterotrophic feeding, and access to heterotrophic resources. I also found that a higher number of individuals fluoresced who were native to the exposed environment and indicates that fluorescence may be influenced more by adaptation than acclimation. So in summary, I confirmed higher heat tolerance of hard coral cover at the sheltered site, which is in line with previous literature. However, I found that corals from high variable environment lost their thermal tolerance post-transplantation, indicating that the plasticity of these corals may limit their use for restoration projects outside of their native habitat. I also found that the high variable environment increased resilience and heat tolerance of corals from a low variable environment via acclimation responses, faster than natural selection and over a small spatial scale. Fluorescence was a key contributing factor to higher percent survival and faster recovery, and is evidence to the importance of monitoring fluorescence in bleaching events, which may indicate survivorship. So to answer my question, habitat of origin doesn't necessarily determine post-transplantation performance, at least in this particular site. However, there are many limiting factors during the study, and so further research is needed at this site to fully understand the mechanisms behind these thermal responses. So with that, I'd like to thank my supervisors and colleagues at CALS who made this research possible. And again, I would like to thank Reef Futures for giving me the opportunity to present this research.